Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The Yearling by Marjorie Kinnan Rawlings, narrated by Tom Stechschulte.
Chapter 1. A column of smoke rose thin and straight from the cabin chimney. The smoke was blue where it left the red of the clay. It trailed into the blue of the April sky and was no longer blue, but gray. The boy Jody watched it, speculating. The fire on the kitchen hearth was dying down. His mother was hanging up pots and pans after the noon meal. The day was Friday. She would sweep the floor with a broom of tie-tie, and after that, if he were lucky, she would scrub it with a corn shuck scrub. If she scrubbed the floor, she would not miss him until he had reached the glen. He stood a minute, balancing the hoe on his shoulder. The clearing itself was pleasant, if the unweeded rows of young shafts of corn were not before him. The wild bees had found the chinaberry tree by the front gate. They burrowed into the fragile clusters of lavender bloom as greedily as though there were no other flowers in the scrub, as though they had forgotten the yellow jessamine of March, the sweet bay and magnolias ahead of them in May. It occurred to him that he might follow the swift line of flight of the black and gold bodies, and so find a bee tree full of amber honey. The winter's cane syrup was gone and most of the jellies. Finding a bee tree was nobler work than hoeing, and the corn could wait another day. The afternoon was alive with a soft stirring. It bored into him as the bees bored into the chinaberry blossoms, so that he must be gone across the clearing, through the pines, and down the road to the running branch. The bee tree might be near the water. He stood his hoe against the split rail fence. He walked down the cornfield until he was out of sight of the cabin. He swung himself over the fence on his two hands. Old Julia, the hound, had followed his father in the wagon to Grahamsville. But Rip, the bulldog, and Perk, the new feist, saw the form clear the fence and ran toward him. Rip barked deeply, but the voice of the small mongrel was high and shrill. They wagged deprecatory short tails when they recognized him. He sent them back to the yard. They watched after him indifferently. They were a sorry pair, he thought, good for nothing but the chase, the catch, and the kill. They had no interest in him except when he brought them their plates of table scraps, night and morning. Old Julia was a gentle thing with humans, but her worn-toothed devotion was only for his father, Penny Baxter. Jody had tried to make up to Julia, but she would have none of him. "You was pups together," his father told him. 10 year gone, when you was 2 year old and her a baby. You hurted the little thing, not meaning no harm. She can't bring herself to trust you. Hounds is often that away." He made a circle around the sheds and corn crib and cut south through the blackjack. He wished he had a dog like Grandma Hutto's. It was white and curly-haired and did tricks. When Grandma Hutto laughed and shook and could not stop, the dog jumped into her lap and licked her face, wagging its plumed tail as though it laughed with her. He would like anything that was his own, that licked his face and followed him as old Julia followed his father. He cut into the sand road and began to run east. It was 2 miles to the glen, but it seemed to Jody that he could run forever. There was no ache in his legs as when he hoed the corn. He slowed down to make the road last longer. He had passed the big pines and left them behind. Where he walked now, the scrub had closed in, walling in the road with dense sand pines, each one so thin it seemed to the boy it might make kindling by itself. The road went up an incline. At the top, he stopped. The April sky was framed by the tawny sand and the pines. It was as blue as his homespun shirt, dyed with Grandma Hutto's indigo. Small clouds were stationary, like bowls of cotton. As he watched, the sunlight left the sky a moment, and the clouds were gray. "There'll come a little old drizzly rain before nightfall," he thought. The downgrade tempted him to elope. He reached the thick-bedded sand of the Silver Glen Road. The tar flower was in bloom, the fetter bush, and sparkleberry. He slowed to a walk, so that he might pass the changing vegetation tree by tree, bush by bush, each one unique and familiar. He reached the magnolia tree, where he had carved the wildcat's face. The growth was a sign that there was water nearby. It seemed a strange thing to him, when earth was earth and rain was rain, that scrawny pines should grow in the scrub, while by every branch and lake and river there grew magnolias. Dogs were the same everywhere, and oxen and mules and horses, but trees were different in different places. "Reckon it's because they can't move none," he decided. They took what food was in the soil under them. The east bank of the road shelved suddenly. It dropped below him 20 feet to a spring. The bank was dense with magnolia and loblolly bay, sweet gum, and gray-barked ash. He went down to the spring in the cool darkness of their shadows. A sharp pleasure came over him. This was a secret and lovely place. A spring as clear as well water bubbled up from nowhere in the sand. It was as though the banks cupped green leafy hands to hold it. There was a whirlpool where the water rose from the earth. Grains of sand boiled in it. Beyond the bank, the parent spring bubbled up at a higher level, cut itself a channel through white limestone, and began to run rapidly downhill to make a creek. The creek joined Lake George. Lake George was a part of the St. John's River. The great river flowed northward and into the sea. It excited Jody to watch the beginning of the ocean. There were other beginnings, true, but this one was his own. He liked to think that no one came here but himself and the wild animals and the thirsty birds. He was warm from his jaunt. The dusky glen laid cool hands on him. He rolled up the hems of his blue denim breeches and stepped with bare, dirty feet into the shallow spring. His toes sunk into the sand. It oozed softly between them and over his bony ankles. The water was so cold that for a moment it burned his skin. Then it made a rippling sound flowing past his pipe-stem legs and was entirely delicious. He walked up and down, digging his big toe experimentally under smooth rocks he encountered. A school of minnows flashed ahead of him down the growing branch. He chased them through the shallows. They were suddenly out of sight as though they had never existed. He crouched under a bared and overhanging live oak root where a pool was deep, thinking they might reappear. But only a spring frog wriggled from under the mud, stared at him, and dove under the tree root in a spasmodic terror. He laughed. "I ain't no coon. I'd not catch you," he called after it. A breeze parted the canopied limbs over him. The sun dropped through and lay on his head and shoulders. It was good to be warm at his head while his hard, calloused feet were cold. The breeze died away. The sun no longer reached him. He waded across to the opposite bank where the growth was more open. A low palmetto brushed him. It reminded him that his knife was snug in his pocket, that he had planned as long ago as Christmas to make himself a flutter mill. He had never built one alone. Grandma Hutto's son, Oliver, had always made one for him whenever he was home from sea. He went to work intently, frowning as he tried to recall the exact angle necessary to make the mill wheel turn smoothly. He cut 2 forked twigs and trimmed them into 2 Ys of the same size. Oliver had been very particular to have the crossbar round and smooth, he remembered. A wild cherry grew halfway up the bank. He climbed it and cut a twig as even as a polished pencil. He selected a palm frond and cut 2 strips of the tough fiber, 1 inch wide and 4 inches long. He cut a slit lengthwise in the center of each of them, wide enough to insert the cherry twig. The strips of palm frond must be at angles, like the arms of a windmill. He adjusted them carefully. He separated the Y-shaped twigs by nearly the length of the cherry crossbar and pushed them deep into the sand of the branch bed a few yards below the spring. The water was only a few inches deep, but it ran strongly, with a firm current. The palm-frond mill wheel must just brush the water's surface. He experimented with depth until he was satisfied, then laid the cherry bar between the twigs. It hung motionless. He twisted it a moment, anxiously, helping to fit itself into its forked grooves. The bar began to rotate. The current caught the flexible tip of one bit of palm frond. By the time it lifted clear, the rotation of the bar brought the angled tip of the second into contact with the stream. The small leafy paddles swung over and over, up and down. The little wheel was turning. The flutter mill was at work. It turned with the easy rhythm of the great water mill at Lynn that ground corn into meal. Jody drew a deep breath. He threw himself on the weedy sand close to the water and abandoned himself to the magic of motion. Up, over, down, up, over, down, the flutter mill was enchanting. The bubbling spring would rise forever from the earth. The thin current was endless. The spring was the beginning of waters sliding to the sea. Unless leaves fell or squirrels cut sweet bay twigs to drop and block the fragile wheel, the flutter mill might turn forever. When he was an old man, as old as his father, there seemed no reason why this rippling movement might not continue as he had begun it. He moved a stone that was matching its corners against his sharp ribs and burrowed a little, hollowing himself a nest for his hips and shoulders. He stretched out one arm and laid his head on it. A shaft of sunlight, warm and thin, like a light patchwork quilt, lay across his body. He watched the flutter mill indolently, sunk in the sand and the sunlight. The movement was hypnotic. His eyelids fluttered with the palm leaf paddles. Drops of silver slipping from the wheel blurred together like the tail of a shooting star. The water made a sound like kittens lapping. A rain frog sang a moment and then was still. There was an instant when the boy hung at the edge of a high bank made of the soft fluff of broom sage, and the rain frog and the starry dripping of the flutter mill hung with him. Instead of falling over the edge, he sank into the softness. The blue, white-tufted sky closed over him. He slept. When he awakened, he thought he was in a place other than the branch bed. He was in another world, so that for an instant, he thought he might still be dreaming. The sun was gone, and all the light and shadow. There were no black bowls of live oaks, no glossy green of magnolia leaves, no pattern of gold lace where the sun had sifted through the branches of the wild cherry. The world was all a gentle gray, and he lay in a mist as fine as spray from a waterfall. The mist tickled his skin. It was scarcely wet. It was at once warm and cool. He rolled over on his back, and it was as though he looked up into the soft gray breast of a mourning dove. He lay, absorbing the fine-dropped rain like a young plant. When his face was damp at last and his shirt was moist to the touch, he left his nest. He stopped short. A deer had come to the spring while he was sleeping. The fresh tracks came down the east bank and stopped at the water's edge. They were sharp and pointed, the tracks of a doe. They sank deeply into the sand so that he knew the doe was an old one and a large. Perhaps she was heavy with fawn. She had come down and drunk deeply from the spring, not seeing him where he slept. Then she had scented him. There was a scuffled confusion in the sand where she had wheeled in fright. The tracks up the opposite bank had long, harried streaks behind them. Perhaps she had not drunk after all before she scented him and turned and ran with that swift, sand-throwing flight. He hoped she was not now thirsty, wide-eyed in the scrub. He looked about for other tracks. The squirrels had raced up and down the banks, but they were bold, always. A raccoon had been that way, with his feet like sharp-nailed hands, but he could not be sure how recently. Only his father could tell for certain the hour when any wild things had passed by. Only the doe had surely come and had been frightened. He turned back again to the flutter mill. It was turning as steadily as though it had always been there. The palm leaf paddles were frail, but they made a brave show of strength, rippling against the shallow water. They were glistening from the slow rain. Jody looked at the sky. He couldn't tell the time of day in the grayness, nor how long he may have slept. He bounded up the west bank, where the open gallberry flats spread without obstructions. As he stood, hesitant whether to go or stay, the rain ended as gently as it had begun. A light breeze stirred from the southwest. The sun came out. The clouds rolled together into great white billowing feather bolsters. And across the east, a rainbow arched, so lovely and so various that Jody thought he would burst with looking at it. The earth was pale green, the air itself was all but visible, golden with the rain-washed sunlight, and all the trees and grass and bushes glittered, varnished with the raindrops. A spring of delight boiled up within him as irresistibly as the spring of the branch. He lifted his arms and held them straight from his shoulders, like a water turkey's wings. He began to whirl around in his tracks. He whirled faster and faster until his ecstasy was a whirlpool, and when he thought he would explode with it, he became dizzy and closed his eyes and dropped to the ground and lay flat in the broom sage. The earth whirled under him and with him. He opened his eyes, and the blue April sky and the cotton clouds whirled over him. Boy and earth and trees and sky spun together. The whirling stopped, his head cleared, and he got to his feet. He was lightheaded and giddy, but something in him was relieved, and the April day could be born again, like any ordinary day. He turned and galloped toward home. He drew deep breaths of the pines, aromatic with wetness. The loose sand that had pulled at his feet was firmed by the rain. The return was comfortable going. The sun was not far from its setting when the longleaf pines around the Baxter clearing came into sight. They stood tall and dark against the red-gold west. He heard the chickens clucking and quarreling and knew they had just been fed. He turned into the clearing. The weathered gray of the split-rail fence was luminous in the rich spring light. Smoke curled thickly from the stick-and-clay chimney. Supper would be ready on the hearth and hot bread baking in the Dutch oven. He hoped his father hadn't returned from Grahamsville. It came to him for the first time that perhaps he shouldn't have left the place while his father was away. If his mother had needed wood, she would be angry. Even his father would shake his head a little and say, "Son." He heard old Caesar snort and knew his father was ahead of him. The clearing was in a pleasant clatter. The horse whinnied at the gate, the calf bleated in its stall, and the milch cow answered. The chickens scratched and cackled, and the dogs barked with the coming of food and evening. It was good to be hungry and to be fed, and the stock was eager with an expectant certainty. The end of winter had been meager. Corn short, and hay, and dried cow peas. But now, in April, the pastures were green and succulent, and even the chickens savored the sprouts of young grass. The dogs had found a nest of young rabbits that evening, and after such tidbits, the scraps from the Baxter supper table were a matter of some indifference. Jody saw old Julia lying under the wagon, worn out from her miles of trotting. He swung open the front paling gate and went to find his father. Penny Baxter was at the woodpile. He still wore the coat of the broadcloth suit that he had been married in, that he now wore as a badge of his gentility when he went to church or off trading. The sleeves were too short, not because Penny had grown, but because the years of hanging through the summer dampness and being pressed with the smoothing iron and pressed again had somehow shrunk the fabric. Jody saw his father's hands, big for the rest of him, close around a bundle of wood. He was doing Jody's work, and in his good coat. Jody ran to him. "I'll get it, Pa." He hoped his willingness now would cover his delinquency. His father straightened his back. "I near about give you out, son," he said.
"I went to the Glen."
"It were a mighty purty day to go," Penny said, "or to go anywhere. How come you to take out such fur a piece?"
It was as hard to remember why he had gone as though it had been a year ago. He had to think back to the moment when he had laid down his hoe.
"Oh," he had it now, "I aimed to follow the honeybees and find a bee tree."
"You find it?"
Jody stared blankly.
"Dogged if I ain't forgot till now to look for it."
He felt as foolish as a bird dog caught chasing field mice. He looked at his father sheepishly. His father's pale blue eyes were twinkling.
"Tell the truth, Jody," he said, "and shame the devil. Wasn't that bee tree a fine excuse to go rambling?"
Jody grinned.
"The notion taken me," he admitted, "afore I studied on the bee tree."
"That's what I figured. How come me to know? Was when I was driving along to Grahamsville, I said to myself, there's Jody now, and the hoeing ain't going to take him too long. What would I do this fine spring day was I a boy? And then I thought, I'd go a-rambling, most anywhere, long as it kivered the ground."
A warmth filled the boy that was not the low golden sun. He nodded.
"That's the way I figured," he said.
"But your ma now," Penny jerked his head toward the house, "don't hold with rambling. Most women folks can't see for their lives how a man loves so to ramble. I never let on you wasn't here. She said, 'Where's Jody?' And I said, 'Oh, I reckon he's around somewheres.'"
He winked one eye and Jody winked back.
"Men folks has got to stick together in the name of peace. You carry your ma a good bait of wood now."
Jody filled his arms and hurried to the house. His mother was kneeling at the hearth. The spiced smells that came to his nose made him weak with hunger.
"That ain't sweet tater pone, is it, Ma?"
"It's sweet tater pone, and don't you fellers be too long a time now, piddling around and visiting. Supper's done and ready."
He dumped the wood in the box and scurried to the lot. His father was milking Trixie.
"Ma says to get done and come on," he reported. "Must I feed old Caesar?"
"I done fed him, son, sich as I had to give the poor feller."
He stood up from the three-legged milking stool.
"Carry in the milk and don't trip and waste it out in the gourd like you done yesterday. Easy, Trixie."
He moved aside from the cow and went to the stall in the shed where a calf was tethered.
"Here, Trixie, soo gal."
The cow lowed and came to her calf.
"Easy there. You greedy as Jody."
He stroked the pair and followed the boy to the house. They washed and turned at the water shelf and dried their hands and faces on the roller towel hanging outside the kitchen door. Ma Baxter sat at the table waiting for them, helping their plates. Her bulky frame filled the end of the long, narrow table. Jody and his father sat down on either side of her. It seemed natural to both of them that she should preside.
"You all hungry tonight?" she asked.
"I can hold a barrel of meat and a bushel of biscuit," Jody said. "That's what you say. Your eyes is bigger than your belly."
"I'd about say the same," Penny said, "if I hadn't learned better. Going to Grahamsville allus do make me hungry."
"You get a snort of shine there is the reason," she said.
"A mighty small one today. Jim Turnbuckle treated."
"Then you sure didn't get enough to hurt you."
Jody heard nothing, saw nothing but his plate. He had never been so hungry in his life. And after a lean winter and slow spring, with food not much more plentiful for the Baxters than for their stock, his mother had cooked a supper good enough for the preacher. There were poke greens with bits of white bacon buried in them, sandbuggers made of potato and onion, and the cooter he had found crawling yesterday. Sour orange biscuits, and at his mother's elbow, the sweet potato pone. He was torn between his desire for more biscuits and another sandbugger, and the knowledge, born of painful experience, that if he ate them, he would suddenly have no room for Pone. The choice was plain.
"Ma," he said, "can I have my Pone right now?"
She was at a pause in the feeding of her own large frame. She cut him, dexterously, a generous portion. He plunged into its spiced and savory goodness.
"The time it taken me," she complained, "to make that Pone, and you destroying it before I get my breath." "I'm eating it quick," he admitted, "but I'll remember it a long time."
Supper was done with. Jody was replete. Even his father, who usually ate like a sparrow, had taken a second helping. "I'm full, thank the Lord," he said. Ma Baxter sighed.
"If a feller'd light me a candle," she said, "I'd get shut of the dishwashing and maybe have time to sit and enjoy myself."
Jody left his seat and lit a tallow candle. As the yellow flame wavered, he looked out of the east window. The full moon was rising.
"A pity to waste light, ain't it?" his father said. "And the full moon shining."
He came to the window and they watched it together.
"Son, what do it put in your head? Do you mind what we said we'd do? Full moon in April?"
"I disremember."
Somehow the seasons always took him unawares. It must be necessary to be as old as his father to keep them in mind and memory, to remember moon time from one year's end to another.
"You ain't forgot what I told you." "I'll swear, Jody. Why, boy, the bears comes out in their winter beds on the full moon in April."
"Old Slewfoot. You said we'd lay for him when he come out."
"That's it."
"You said we'd go where we see his tracks coming and going and crisscrossing, and likely find his bed and him too coming out in April."
"And fat. Fat and lazy. The meat's so sweet from him laying up."
"And him maybe easier to catch? Not woke up good?"
"That's it."
"When can we go, Paul?"
"Soon as we get the hoeing done and see bear sign."
"Which way will we be hunting him?"
"We'd best to go by the Glen Springs and see has he come out and watered there."
"A big old doe watered there today," Jody said, "whilst I was asleep. I built me a flutter mill, Pa. It run fine."
Ma Baxter stopped the clatter of her pots and pans.
"You sly scaper," she said. "That's the first I knowed you been off. You getting slick as a clay road in the rain."
He shouted with laughter.
"I fooled you, Ma. Say it, Ma. I got to fool you once it. You fooled me, and me standing over the fire making potato pone."
She was not truly angry.
"Now, Ma," he cajoled her, "suppose I was a varmint and didn't eat nothing but roots and grass. I'd not have nothing then to rile me," she said.
At the same time, he saw her mouth twist. She tried to straighten it and could not.
"Ma's a-laughin', Ma's a-laughin'. You ain't riled when you laugh."
He darted behind her and untied her apron strings. The apron slipped to the floor. She turned her bulk quickly and boxed his ears, but the blows were feather-light and playful. The same delirium came over him again that he had felt in the afternoon. He began to whirl around and around as he had done in the broom sage.
"You knock them plates off'n the table," she said, "and you'll see who's riled." "I can't help it. I'm dizzy." "You're addled," she said. "Just plain addled."
It was true. He was addled with April. He was dizzy with spring. He was as drunk as Lem Forrester on a Saturday night. His head was swimming with the strong brew made up of the sun and the air and the thin gray rain. The flutter mill had made him drunk, and the doe's coming, and his father's hiding his absence, and his mother's making him a pone and laughing at him. He was stabbed with a candlelight inside the safe comfort of the cabin, with the moonlight around it. He pictured old Slewfoot, the great black outlaw bear with one toe missing, rearing up in his winter bed, and tasting the soft air and smelling the moonlight, as he, Jody, smelled and tasted them. He went to bed in a fever and couldn't sleep. A mark was on him from the day's delight, so that all his life, when April was a thin green and the flavor of rain was on his tongue, an old wound would throb and a nostalgia would fill him for something he could not quite remember. A whippoorwill called across the bright night, and suddenly he was asleep. Chapter 2. Penny Baxter lay awake beside the vast sleeping bulk of his wife. He was always wakeful on the full moon. He had often wondered whether, with the light so bright, men were not meant to go into their fields and labor. He would like to slip from his bed and perhaps cut down an oak for wood or finish the hoeing that Jody had left undone.
"I reckon I ought to have crawled him about it," he thought.
In his day, he would have been thoroughly thrashed for slipping away and idling. His father would have sent him back to the spring without a supper to tear out the flutter mill.
"But that's it," he thought. "A boy ain't a boy too long."
As he looked back over the years, he himself had had no boyhood. His own father had been a preacher, stern as the Old Testament God. The living had come, however, not from the Word, but from the small farm near Volusia, on which he had raised a large family. He had taught them to read and write and to know the scriptures, but all of them, from the time they could toddle behind him down the corn rows carrying the sack of seed, had toiled until their small bones ached and their growing fingers cramped. Rations had been short and hookworm abundant. Penny had grown to maturity no bigger than a boy. His feet were small, his shoulders narrow, his ribs and hips jointed together in a continuous fragile framework. He had stood among the foresters one day like an ash sapling among giant oaks. Lem Forrester looked down at him and said,
"Why, you little old penny piece, you. You're good money, I write, but it just don't come no smaller. Little old Penny Baxter."
The name had been his only one ever since. When he voted, he signed himself Ezra Ezekiel Baxter, but when he paid his taxes, he was put down as Penny Baxter and made no protest. But he was a sound amalgam, sound as copper itself, and with something, too, of the copper softness. He leaned backward in his honesty, so that he was often a temptation to storekeepers and mill owners and horse traders. Storekeeper Boyles at Volusia, as honest as he, had once given him a dollar too much in change. His horse being lame, Penny had walked the long miles back again to return it.
"The next time you came to trade would have done," Boyles said.
"I know," Penny answered him, "but 'twan't mine, and I wouldn't have wanted to die with it on me. Dead or alive, I only want what's mine."
The remark might have explained to those who puzzled at him his migration to the adjacent scrub. Folk who lived along the deep and placid river, alive with craft, with dugouts and scows, lumber rafts and freight and passenger vessels, side-wheel steamers that almost filled the stream in places from bank to bank, had said that Penny Baxter was either a brave man or a crazy one to leave the common way of life and take his bride into the very heart of the wild Florida scrub, populous with bears and wolves and panthers. It had been understandable for the foresters to go there, for the growing family of great, burly, quarrelsome males needed all the room in the county and freedom from any hindrance. But who would hinder Penny Baxter? It was not hindrance. But in the towns and villages, in farming sections where neighborhoods were not too far apart, men's minds and actions and property overlapped. There were intrusions on the individual spirit. There were friendliness and mutual help in time of trouble, true, but there were bickerings and watchfulness, one man suspicious of another. He had grown from under the sternness of his father into a world less direct, less honest in its harshness, and therefore more disturbing. He had perhaps been bruised too often. The peace of the vast, aloof scrub had drawn him with the beneficence of its silence. Something in him was raw and tender. The touch of men was hurtful upon it, but the touch of the pines was healing. Making a living came harder there. Distances were troublesome in the buying of supplies and the marketing of crops. But the clearing was peculiarly his own. The wild animals seemed less predatory to him than people he had known. The forays of bear and wolf and wildcat and panther on stock were understandable, which was more than he could say of human cruelties. In his 30s, he had married a buxom girl already twice his size, loaded her in an ox cart along with the rudiments of housekeeping, and jogged with her to the clearing, where with his own hands he had reared a cabin. He had chosen his land as well as a man might choose in the brooding expanse of scrawny sand pines. He had bought of the foresters, who lived a safe 4 miles away, high, good land in the center of a pine island. The island was called by such a name, in an arid forest, because it was literally an island of long-leaf pines, lifted high, a landmark in the rolling sea that was the scrub. There were other such islands scattered to the north and west, where some accident of soil or moisture produced patches of luxuriant growth, even of hammock, the richest growth of all. Live oaks were here and there, the red bay and the magnolia, wild cherry and sweet gum, hickory and holly. A scarcity of water was the only drawback to the location. The water level lay so deep that wells were priceless. Water for inhabitants of Baxter's Island must come, until bricks and mortar were cheaper, from the great sinkhole on the western boundary of the 100-acre tract. The sinkhole was a phenomenon common to the Florida limestone regions. Underground rivers ran through such sections. The bubbling springs that turned at once into creeks and runs were outbreaks of these. Sometimes a thin shell of surface soil caved in, and a great cavern was revealed, with or without a flow of water. The sinkhole included with Penny Baxter's land contained, unfortunately, no flowing spring. But a pure, filtered water seeped day and night through the high banks and formed a pool at the bottom. The foresters had tried to sell Penny poor land in the scrub itself, but with cash to back him, he had insisted on the island. He had said to them, "The scrub's a fitting place for the game to raise and all the wild things, foxes and deer and panther cats and rattlesnakes. I can't raise young'uns in a pure thicket." The foresters had slapped their thighs and roared with laughter from their beards. Lem had bellowed, "How many hay pennies is in a penny? You'll do good, be you a daddy to a fox cub." Penny could hear him now, after all the years. He turned over in his bed, cautiously, not to awaken his wife. He had indeed planned boldly for sons and daughters, moving in prolific plenty among the longleaf pines. The family had come. Ora Baxter was plainly built for childbearing, but it had seemed as though his seed were as puny as himself. "Or Lem put a mouth on me," he thought. The babies were frail, and almost as fast as they came, they sickened and died. Penny had buried them one by one in a cleared place among the blackjack oaks, where the poor, loose soil made the digging easier. The plot grew in size until he was compelled to fence it in against the vandalism of hogs and polecats. He had carved little wooden tombstones for all. He could picture them now, standing white and straight in the moonlight. Some of them had names. Ezra Jr., Little Aura, William T. The others bore only such legends as Baby Baxter, aged 3 months, 6 days. On one, Penny had scratched laboriously with his pocket knife, "She never saw the light of day." His mind moved back down the years, touching them as a man touches fence posts in his passing. There had been a hiatus in the births. Then, when the loneliness of the place had begun to frighten him a little, and his wife was almost past the age of bearing, Jody Baxter was born and thrived. When the baby was a toddling 2-year-old, Penny had gone to the war. He had taken his wife and child to the river to live with his crony, Grandma Hutto, for the few months he expected to be away. He had come back at the end of 4 years with the mark of age on him. He had gathered up his wife and boy and taken them back to the scrub with gratitude for its peace and isolation. Jody's mother had accepted her youngest with something of detachment, as though she had given all she had of love and care and interest to those others. But Penny's bowels yearned over his son. He gave him something more than his paternity. He found that the child stood wide-eyed and breathless before the miracle of bird and creature, of flower and tree, of wind and rain and sun and moon, as he had always stood. And if, on a soft day in April, the boy had prowled away on his boy's business, he could understand the thing that had drawn him. He understood, too, its briefness. His wife's bulk stirred, and she made a sound in her sleep. He would act on any such occasion, he knew, as a bulwark for the boy against the mother's sharpness. The whippoorwill flew farther into the forest and took up his lament again, sweet with distance. The moonlight moved beyond the focus of the bedroom window.
"Leave him kick up his heels," he thought, "and run away. Leave him build his flutter mills. The day'll come. He'll not even care to."
Chapter 3. Jody opened his eyes unwillingly. Sometime, he thought, he would slip away into the woods and sleep from Friday until Monday. Daylight was showing through the east window of his small bedroom. He couldn't be certain whether it was the pale light that had awakened him or the stirring of the chickens in the peach trees. He heard them fluttering one by one from their roost in the branches. The daylight lay in orange streaks. The pines beyond the clearing were still black against it. Now, in April, the sun was rising earlier. It couldn't be very late. It was good to awaken by himself before his mother called him. He turned over luxuriously. The dry corn shucks of his mattress rustled under him. The Dominic rooster crowed boisterously under the window.
"You crow now," the boy said. "See, can you rout me out?"
The bright streaks in the east thickened and blended. A golden flush spread as high as the pines, and as he watched, the sun itself lifted, like a vast copper skillet being drawn to hang among the branches. A light wind stirred, as though the growing light had pushed it out of the restless east. The sacking curtains eddied out into the room. The breeze reached the bed and brushed him with the cool softness of clean fur. He lay for a moment in torment between the luxury of his bed and the coming day. Then he was out of his nest and standing on the deerskin rug, and his breeches were hanging handily, and his shirt right side out by good fortune, and he was in them, and dressed, and there was not any need of sleep or anything but the day, and the smell of hot cakes in the kitchen.
"Hey, old Ma," he said at the door. "I like you, Ma." "You and them hounds and all the rest of the stock," she said. "Mighty lovin' on an empty belly and me with a dish in my hand." "That's the way you're purtiest," he said, and grinned.
He went whistling to the water shelf and dipped into the wooden bucket to fill the wash basin. He sousled his hands and face in the water, deciding against the strong lye soap. He wet his hair and parted and smoothed it with his fingers. He took down the small mirror from the wall and studied himself a moment.
"I'm torrible ugly, Ma," he called. "Well, there ain't been a purty Baxter since the name begun."
He wrinkled his nose at the mirror. The gesture made the freckles across the bridge blend together.
"I wish it I was dark like the foresters." "You be proud you ain't. Them fellers as black as their hearts. You a Baxter and all the Baxters is fair."
"You talk like I wasn't no kin to you."
My folks runs to fairness, too. They ain't none of 'em puny, though. If and you'll learn yourself to work, you'll be your pa all over.
The mirror showed a small face with high cheekbones. The face was freckled and pale, but healthy, like a fine sand. The hair grieved him on the occasions when he went to church or any doings at Volusia. It was straw-colored and shaggy, and no matter how carefully his father cut it, once a month on the Sunday morning nearest the full moon, it grew in tufts at the back. Drake's tails, his mother called them. His eyes were wide and blue. When he frowned, in close study over his reader, or watching something curious, they narrowed. It was then that his mother claimed him kin.
"He do favor the Alverses a mite," she said.
Jody turned the mirror to inspect his ears, not for cleanliness, but remembering the pain of the day when Lem Forrester had held his chin with one vast hand and pulled his ears with the other.
"Boy, your ears is set up on your head like a possum's," Lem said.
Jody made a leering grimace at himself and returned the mirror to the wall.
"Do we got to wait for Pa to eat breakfast?" he asked.
"We do. Set it all in front of you, and there'd likely not be enough left for him."
He hesitated at the back door.
"And don't you slip off, neither. He ain't but to the corn crib."
From the south, beyond the blackjacks, he heard the bell-like voice of old Julia, giving tongue in great excitement. He thought he heard, too, his father giving her a command. He bolted away before his mother's sharp voice could stop him. She, too, had heard the dog. She followed to the door and called after him.
"Don't you and your pa be gone too long now, follerin' that fool hound. I'm a no mind to set around waitin' breakfast, and you two piddlin' around in the woods."
He could no longer hear either old Julia or his father. He was in a frenzy for fear the excitement was over. The intruder gone, and perhaps dog and father with it. He crashed through the blackjacks in the direction from which the sounds had come. His father's voice spoke, close at hand.
"Easy, son. What's done'll wait for you."
He stopped short. Old Julia stood trembling, not in fear, but in eagerness. His father stood looking down at the crushed and mangled carcass of Black Betsy, the brood sow.
"He must have heard me daring him," Penny said. "Look careful, boy. See, do you see what I see?"
The sight of the mutilated sow sickened him. His father was looking beyond the dead animal. Old Julia had her sharp nose turned in the same direction. Jody walked a few paces and examined the sand. The unmistakable tracks made his blood jump. They were the tracks of a giant bear. And from the print of the right front paw, as big as the crown of a hat, one toe was missing.
"Old Slewfoot,"
Penny nodded.
"I'm proud you remembered his track."
They bent together and studied the signs and the direction in which they had both come and gone.
"That's what I call," Penny said, "carrying the war into the enemy's camp."
"None of the dogs bayed him, Pa. Lesson I didn't hear for sleeping."
"None of them bayed him. He had the wind in his favor. Don't you think he didn't know what he was doing? He slipped in like a shadow and done his meanness and slipped out afore day."
A chill ran along Jody's backbone. He could picture the shadow, big and black as a shed in motion, moving among the blackjacks and gathering in the tame and sleeping sow with one sweep of the great clawed paw. Then the white tusks followed into the backbone, crushing it, and into the warm and palpitating flesh. Betsy had had no chance even to squeal for help.
"He'd already fed," Penny pointed out. "He ain't no more'n a mouthful. Bear's stomach is shrunk when he first comes out in his winter bed. That's why I hate a bear. A creature that kills and eats what he needs, why, he's just like the rest of us, making out the best he can. But an animal or a person either, that'll do harm just to be a-doin'. You look in a bear's face, and you'll see he's got no remorse."
"You aim to carry in old Betsy?"
The meat's bad tore up, but I reckon there's sausage left, and lard.
Jody knew that he should feel badly about old Betsy, but all that he could feel was excitement. The unwarranted kill inside the sanctuary of the Baxter Acres had made a personal enemy of the big bear that had evaded all the stock owners for 5 years. He was wild to begin the hunt. He acknowledged to himself as well a trace of fear. Old Slewfoot had struck close to home. He took one hind leg of the sow and Penny the other. They dragged it to the house with Julia reluctant at their heels. The old bear dog couldn't understand why they didn't set out at once on the chase.
"I'll swear," Penny said, "I'm daresome to break the news to your ma."
"She'll rare for certain," Jody agreed.
"Betsy was such a fine brood sow. My, she was fine."
Ma Baxter was waiting for them by the gate.
"I've been a-callin' and I've been a-callin'," she hailed them. "What you got there, piddling around so long?" "Oh, dear goodness, oh, dear goodness, my sow, my sow."
She threw her arms toward the sky. Penny and Jody passed through the gate and back of the house. She followed, wailing.
"We'll hang the meat to the cross piece, son," Penny said. "Dogs'll not reach it there."
"You might tell me," Ma Baxter said. "The least you can do is tell me. How come her dead and tore to ribbons right under my nose?"
"Old Slewfoot done it, Ma," Jody said. "His tracks was certain.
And them dogs asleep right here in the clearing?"
The three had already appeared, nosing about the fresh smell of the blood. She threw a stick in their direction.
"You no account creeters! Hornin' in on our rations and leavin' sech as this to happen."
"Ain't a dog born as smart as that bear," Penny said.
"They could have barked."
She threw another stick and the dog slunk away. The family went to the house. In the confusion, Jody went first into the kitchen where the smell of breakfast tortured him. His mother couldn't be too disturbed to notice what he was doing.
"You get right back here," she called, "and wash your dirty hands."
He joined his father at the water shelf. Breakfast was on the table. Ma Baxter sat, swaying her body in distress, and didn't eat. Jody heaped his plate. There were grits and gravy, hot cakes and buttermilk.
"Anyway," he said, "we got meat to eat for a whiles now."
She turned on him.
"Meat now, and none this winter."
"I'll ask the foresters out of a sow," Penny said.
"Yes, and be beholden to them rascals."
She began to wail again.
"That blasted bear! I'd like to get my hands on him."
"I'll tell him when I see him," Penny said mildly between mouthfuls.
Jody burst out laughing.
"That's right," she said. "Make a fun box outen me."
Jody patted her big arm.
"It just come to me, Ma. How'd you look? You and old Slewfoot mixing it."
"I'd bet on your Ma," Penny said.
"Nobody but me don't take life serious," she lamented.
Chapter 4. Penny pushed back his plate and stood up from the table.
"Well, son, we got our day's work laid out for us."
Jody's heart fell, hoeing.
"We stand a right good chance of coming up with that bear today."
The sun was bright again.
"Fetch me my shot bag and my powder horn, and the tinder horn."
Jody jumped to bring them.
"Look at him move," his mother said. "To see him hoe, you'd think he was a snail. Say hunting, and he's quick as a otter."
She went to the kitchen safe and took out one of the few remaining glasses of jelly. She spread the jelly on the leftover stack of hot cakes and tied them in a piece of cloth and dropped them in Penny's knapsack. She took the remains of the sweet potato pone and set aside a piece for herself, then added the pone, wrapped in a fragment of paper, to the knapsack. She looked again at the pone she had saved and, with a quick motion, dropped it in the sack with the other.
"This ain't much dinner," she said.
Maybe you'll be soon back.
Don't look for us till you see us, Penny said. Anyways, no man never starved to death in a day.
To hear Jody tell it, she said, he can starve to death about an hour after breakfast.
Penny swung the knapsack and tinderhorn over his shoulder.
Jody, take the big knife and go cut a good strip off in that gator tail.
The meat, dry cured for the feeding of the dogs, hung in the smokehouse. Jody ran to it and swung open the heavy timber door. The smokehouse was dark and cool, odorous with the smell of hams and bacons, dusty with the ash of hickory. The rafters, studded with square-headed nails for the hanging of meats, were now almost bare. Three shoulders of ham hung, lean and withered, and two bacon sides. A haunch of jerked venison swung beside the smoked alligator meat. Old Slewfoot had indeed done damage. Betsy the brood sow would have filled the room with her plump progeny by the coming fall. Jody hacked away a piece of alligator. The meat was dry, but tender. He touched his tongue to it. Its saltiness was not unpleasing. He joined his father in the yard. At sight of the old muzzle-loading shotgun, Julia lifted her voice in a wail of delight. Rip shot from under the house to join her. Perk, the new feist, wagged his tail stupidly and without understanding. Penny patted the dogs in turn.
"You'll likely not be so merry time the day be done," he told them. "Jody boy, you best put on your shoes. It'll be rough going places."
It seemed to Jody that he would burst if there was further delay. He dashed into his room and routed out his heavy cowhide brogans from under the bed. He slipped his feet into them and raced after his father as though the hunt would be done and over before he reached him. Old Julia was loping ahead, her long nose against the trail of the bear.
"The trail not be too cold, Pa? Reckon he won't be gone too fur yonder to catch up with him?"
"He'll be fur yonder, but we got a heap better chance at catching up with him. Do we let him take it easy and give him time to lay up? A bear that knows he's follered moves a sight faster than one that figures the world's his own to prowl and feed in."
The trail led south through the Black Jacks. After the rain of the afternoon before, the great nubbed tracks made a plain pattern across the sand.
"He's got a foot big as a barrel," Penny said.
The Black Jacks ended as though they'd been sown by hand and there had been no more seed in the sack. The land was lower and the growth was of large pines.
"Pa, how big you reckon he be?"
"He's big. He ain't full weight right now, account of his stomach being shrunk up from laying up and empty. But look at that track. It's sizable enough to prove him. And look at the way it's deeper at the back. A deer track'll prove the same. A deer or bear that's fat and heavy will sink in that-a-way. A little old light doe or yearling will walk tippy-toed, and you'll not see more than the front of their hooves. Oh, he's big."
"You'll not be scared when we come up with him, Pa?"
"Not lessen things go mighty wrong. I'm fearful always for the poor dogs.
They're the scapers gets the worst of it."
Penny's eyes twinkled.
"I don't reckon you'll be scared, son."
"Not me," he thought a moment. "But if I was to be scared, must I climb a tree?"
Penny chuckled.
"Yes, son. Even if you ain't scared, it's a good place to watch the ruckus."
They walked in silence. Old Julia moved certainly. Rip the bulldog was content to follow at her heels, snuffing where she snuffed, stopping when she hesitated. She blew through her soft nose when the grasses tickled it. The feist made dashes to one side or another and once tore wildly after a rabbit that bolted from under his nose. Jody whistled after him.
"Leave him go, son," Penny told him. "He'll join up again when it comes to him. He's lonesome."
Old Julia gave a thin, high wail and looked over her shoulder.
"The wise old scaper's changing his direction," Penny said.
"Likely he's headed for the sawgrass ponds. If and that's his notion, we can maybe slip around and surprise him."
Some understanding came to Jody of the secret of his father's hunting. The foresters, he thought, would have plunged after old Slewfoot the moment they had found his kill. They would have shouted and bellowed. Their pack of dogs would have bayed until the scrub echoed with it, for they encouraged them in it, and the wary old bear would have had full warning of their coming. His father got game 10-1. The little man was famous for it. Jody said,
"You sure can figure what a creeter'll do."
"You belong to figure. A wild critter's quicker'n a man and a heap stronger. What's a man got that a bear ain't got? A mite more sense. He can't outrun a bear, but he's a sorry hunter if he can't outstudy him."
The pines were becoming scattering. There was suddenly a strip of hammock land, and a place of live oaks and scrub palmettos. The undergrowth was thick, laced with cat briars. Then hammock too ended, and to the south and west lay a broad open expanse that looked at first sight to be a meadow. This was the sawgrass. It grew knee-deep in water, its harsh, saw-edged blades rising so thickly that it seemed a compact vegetation. Old Julia splashed into it. The rippling of the water showed the pond. A gust of air passed across the open area. The sawgrass waved and parted, and the shallow water of a dozen ponds showed clearly. Penny watched the hound intently. The treeless expanse seemed to Jody more stirring than the shadowy forest. At any moment, the great black form might rear itself high. He whispered,
"Will we cut around?"
Penny shook his head. He answered in a low voice,
"Wind's wrong. Don't seem to me like he's heading across it nohow."
The hound splashed in a zigzag trail where solid ground edged the sawgrass. Here and there, the scent was lost in the water. Once, she dipped her head to lap, not in thirst, but for the very taste of the trail. She moved confidently down the middle of the pond. Rip and Perk found their short legs too deep in muck for comfort. They retreated to higher ground and shook themselves, watching Julia anxiously. Perk barked shortly, and Penny slapped him for quiet. Jody stepped cautiously behind his father. A blue heron flew low over him without warning, and he started. The pond water was cold an instant against his legs. His breeches were clammy. The muck sucked in his shoes. Then the water was comfortable, and it was good to walk in the wet coolness, leaving sandy whirlpools behind.
"He's feeding on the fire plant," Penny murmured.
He pointed to the flat, arrow-shaped leaves. Edges showed jagged tooth marks. Others were bitten clear of the stalk.
"Hits his spring tonic. A bear'll make for it first thing. Time he comes out in the spring."
He leaned close and touched a leaf whose ragged edge was turning brown.
"Dog it if he wa'n't here a night ago, too. That's how come him to have appetite for a nip of poor old Betsy."
The hound, too, paused. The scent lay now, not underfoot, but on the reeds and grasses where the strong-smelling fur had brushed. She laid her long nose against a bulrush and stared into space. Then, satisfied as to direction, splashed due south at a lively pace. Penny spoke now freely.
"He's done feeding. Old Julia says he's clipping it for home."
He moved to higher land, keeping the hound in sight. He walked briskly, chatting.
"Many's the time I've seen a bear feeding on the fire plant in the moonlight. He'll snort and shuffle and splash and grunt. He'll rip them leaves off'n the stems and cram 'em in his ugly old mouth like a person. Then he'll nose along and chaw, like a dog chawin' grass. And the night birds crying over him, and the bullfrogs hollering like dogs, and the mallards calling, snake, 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 and the drops of water on the leaves of the fire plant shining bright and red as a bull bat's eyes."
It was as good as seeing it to hear Penny tell of it.
"I'd sure love to see a bear feeding on the fire plant, Paul."
"Well, you live long as me, and you'll see that and a heap more things as strange and curious."
"Did you shoot him, Paul? while they was feeding?
Son, I've held back my shot and contented myself with watching many a time when creeters was feeding harmless and innocent. It goes agin me to crack down at sich time, or when creeters is mating. Now and again, when it was get meat or the Baxters go hungry, I've done what I've no liking to do. And don't you grow up like the foresters. Killing meat you got no use for the fun of it. That's evil as the bears. You hear me?
Yes, sir.
Old Julia gave a sharp cry. The trail cut at right angles to the east.
I feared it, Penny said. The bay.
The Red Bay thicket seemed impenetrable. This land of sudden changes gave good cover for the game. Old Slewfoot, in his careless feeding, had never been far from shelter. The bay saplings stood as close together as the palings of a stockade. Jody wondered how the bear had managed to work his bulk among them. But here and there, the saplings thinned, or were young and limber, and he could see plainly marked a common trail. Other creatures had used it. Tracks crossed and crisscrossed. Wildcat had followed deer, lynx had followed wildcat, and all about were the paw prints of the small things, coons and rabbits and possums and skunks, feeding cautiously aside from their predatory kin. Penny said,
I reckon I best load.
He clucked to Julia to wait for him. She lay down knowingly to rest, and Rip and Perk dropped willingly beside her. Jody had been carrying the powder horn over his shoulder. Penny opened it and shook a measure of powder down the muzzle. From his shot bag, he pulled a wisp of dried black Spanish moss, inserted it for wadding, and packed it with a ramrod. He dropped in a measure of low mold shot, more wadding, and at the last, a cap, and used the ramrod lightly again.
All right, Julia. Get him.
The morning's trailing had been a leisurely business, a pleasant jaunting rather than a hunt. Now the dark bay thicket closed in over their heads. Jories flew from the denseness with an alarming whir of wings. The earth was soft and black, and there were scurryings and rustlings on either side in the bushes. On the trail, a bar of sunlight lay occasionally where the thicket parted. The scent, for all the comings and goings, was not confused, for the taint of bear hung heavy in the leafy tunnel. The short fur of the bulldog stood on end. Old Julia ran swiftly. Penny and Jody were forced to stoop to follow. Penny swung the muzzle loader in his right hand, its barrel tipped at an angle, so that if he stumbled and the charge went off, he wouldn't touch the running dogs before him. A branch crashed behind, and Jody clutched at his father's shirt. A squirrel ran chattering away. The thicket thinned. The ground dropped lower and became a swamp. The sunlight came through in patches as big as a basket. There were giant ferns here, taller than their heads. One lay crushed where the bear had moved across it. Its spice sweetness lay heavy on the warm air. A young tendril sprang back into an upright position. Penny pointed to it. Slewfoot, Jody understood, had passed not many minutes before. Old Julia was feverish. The trail was food and drink. Her nose skimmed the damp ground. A scrub jay flew ahead, warning the game and crying, Plick up wah! The swamp dipped to a running branch no broader than a fence post. The print of the nubbed foot spanned it. A water moccasin lifted a curious head, then spun downstream in smooth brown spirals. Across the branch, palmettos grew. The great track continued across the swamp. Jody noticed that the back of his father's shirt was wet. He touched his own sleeve. It was dripping. Suddenly, Julia bayed, and Penny began to run.
The creek! He shouted. He's trying to make the creek!
Sound filled the swamp. Saplings crashed. The bear was a black hurricane mowing down obstructions. The dogs barked and bayed. The roaring in Jody's ears was his heart pounding. A bamboo vine tripped him and he sprawled and was on his feet again. Penny's short legs churned in front of him like paddles. Slewfoot would make Juniper Creek before the dogs could halt him at bay. A clear space opened at the creek's bank. Jody saw a vast, black, shapeless form break through. Penny halted and lifted his gun. On the instant, a small brown missile hurled itself at the shaggy head. Old Julia had caught up with her enemy. She leaped and retreated, and in the moment of retreat was at him again. Rip darted in beside her. Slewfoot wheeled and slashed at him. Julia flashed at his flank. Penny held his fire. He couldn't shoot for the dogs. Old Slewfoot was suddenly deceptively indifferent. He seemed to stand baffled, slow and uncertain, weaving back and forth. He whined like a child whimpering. The dogs backed off an instant. The moment was perfect for a shot, and Penny swung his gun to his shoulder, drew a bead on the left cheek, and pulled the trigger. A harmless pop sounded. He cocked the hammer again and pulled the trigger once more. The sweat stood out on his forehead. Again the hammer clicked futilely. Then a black storm broke. It roared in on the dogs with incredible swiftness. White tusks and curved claws were streaks of lightning across it. It snarled and whirled and gnashed its teeth and slashed in every direction. The dogs were as quick. Julia made swift sorties from the rear, and then Slewfoot wheeled to rake at her. Rip leaped for the hairy throat. Jody was in a paralysis of horror. He saw that his father had cocked the hammer again and stood half-crouching, licking his lips, fingering the trigger. Old Julia bored in at the bear's right flank. He wheeled, not on her, but on the bulldog at his left. He caught him sideways and sent him sprawling into the bushes. Again Penny pulled the trigger. The explosion that followed had a sizzling sound, and Penny fell backward. The gun had backfired. Rip returned to his attempts for the bear's throat, and Julia took up her worrying from the rear. The bear stood again at bay, weaving. Jody ran to his father. Penny was already on his feet. The right side of his face was black with powder. Slewfoot shook free of Rip, whirled to Julia, and caught her to his chest with his cupped claws. She yelped sharply. Rip hurled himself at the back and buried his teeth in the hide. Jody screamed, "He's killing Julia!" Penny ran desperately into the heart of the fracas. He jammed the gun barrel in the bear's ribs. Even in her pain, Julia had taken a grip on the black throat above her. Slewfoot snarled and turned suddenly and plunged down the bank of the creek and into the deep water. Both dogs kept their hold. Slewfoot swam madly. Only Julia's head showed above the water below the bear's snout. Rip rode the broad back with bravado. Slewfoot made the far bank and scrambled up its side. Julia loosened her hold and dropped limply on the earth. The bear plunged toward the dense thicket. For a moment more, Rip stayed with him. Then, confused, he too dropped away and turned back uncertainly to the creek. He snuffed at Julia and sat down on his haunches and howled across the water. There was a crashing in the distant undergrowth, then silence. Penny called, "Here, Rip! Here, Julia!" Rip wagged his stumpy tail and didn't stir. Penny lifted his hunting horn to his lips and blew caressingly. Jody saw Julia lift her head, then fall back again. Penny said, "I got to go fetch her." He slipped off his shoes and slid down the bank into the water. He struck out strongly. A few yards from shore, the current laid hold of him as though he were a log and shot him downstream at a fierce clip. He struggled against it, fighting for distance. Jody saw him stagger to his feet far down the run, wipe the water from his eyes, and push his way back up the shore to his dogs. He leaned to examine the hound, then gathered her under one arm. This time he went some distance upstream before taking to the creek. When he dropped into the water, stroking with his free arm, the current picked him up and deposited him almost at Jody's feet. Rip paddled behind him, landed, and shook himself. Penny laid the old hound down gently. "She's bad hurt," he said. He took off his shirt and trussed the dog in it. He tied the sleeves together to make a sling and hoisted it on his back. "This settles it," he said. "I got to get me a new gun." The powder burn on his cheek had already turned into a blister.
"What's wrong, Pa?"
"Near about everything."
The hammer's loose on the cylinder, I know that. I've been having to cock it 2-3 times right along. But when it backfired, that belongs to mean the mainsprings got weak. Well, let's get going. You tote the blasted old gun.
The procession started homeward through the swamp. Penny cut north and west.
Now I'll not rest till I get that bear, he said. Just give me a new gun and time.
Suddenly Jody couldn't endure the sight of the limp bundle in front of him. There were tricklings of blood down his father's thin bare back.
I want to go ahead, Pa.
Penny turned and eyed him.
Don't go getting faintified on me.
I can break a trail for you.
All right, go ahead. Jody, take the knapsack. Get you some bread. Eat a bite, boy. You'll feel better.
Jody fumbled blindly in the sack and pulled out the parcel of pancakes. The briarberry jelly was tart and cool on his tongue. He was ashamed to have it taste so good. He bolted several of the cakes. He handed some to his father.
Rations is mighty comforting, Penny said.
A whine sounded in the bushes. A small, cringing form was following them. It was Perk, the feist. Jody kicked at him in a fury.
Don't bother him, Penny said. I suspected him all along. There's dogs as bear dogs, and there's dogs just isn't bear dogs.
The feist dropped in at the end of the line. Jody tried to break trail, but fallen trees lay thicker than his body and would not be stirred. Bullbriars, tougher than his father's muscles, snared him, and he could only push his way around them or crawl beneath. Penny, with his burden, had to shift for himself. The swamp was close and humid. Rip was panting. The pancakes lay soothingly in Jody's belly. He reached in the knapsack for the sweet potato pone. His father refused his share, and Jody divided it with Rip. The little feist, he thought, deserved nothing. It was good to clear the swamp at last and come into the open pine woods. Even the scrub that followed after for a mile or two seemed light and penetrable. Pushing through the low scrub oaks, the scrub palmettos, the gallberry bushes, and the tie-tie was less laborious than crossing the swamp. It was late afternoon when the high pines of Baxter's Island showed ahead. The procession filed down the sand road from the east and into the clearing. Rip and Perk ran ahead to the hollowed cypress watering trough kept for the chickens. Ma Baxter sat rocking on the narrow veranda, a mound of mending in her lap.
A dead dog and no bear, eh?
She called.
Not dead yet. Get me water and rags and the big needle and thread.
She rose quickly to help. Jody was always amazed at the capability of her great frame and hands when there was trouble. Penny laid old Julia down on the veranda floor. She whimpered. Jody bent to stroke her head, and she bared her teeth at him. He trailed his mother, disconsolately. She was tearing an old apron into strips.
You can fetch the water,
she told him, and he scurried to the kettle. Penny returned to the veranda with an armful of crocus sacks to make a bed for the hound. Ma Baxter brought the surgical equipment. Penny unwrapped his blood-soaked shirt from the dog and bathed the deep gashes. Old Julia made no protest. She had known claws before. He sewed the two deepest cuts and rubbed pine gum into all of them. She yelped once and then was silent as he worked. A rib, he said, was broken. He could do nothing for that, but if she lived, it would mend. She had lost much blood. Her breath came short. Penny gathered her up, bed and all. Ma Baxter demanded,
Now where are you carrying her?
To the bedroom. I got to watch her tonight.
Not to my bedroom, Ezra Baxter. I'll do for her what's got to be done, but I'll not have you popping in and out in the bed all night waking me. I didn't half sleep last night.
Then I'll sleep with Jody and bed Julia there, he said. I'll not leave her alone in no shed tonight. Fetch me cold water, Jody.
He carried her to Jody's room and laid her in the corner on the pile of sacking. She wouldn't drink, or couldn't, and he opened her mouth and poured water down her dry throat.
Leave her rest now. We'll go do our chores.
The clearing possessed this evening a strange coziness. Jody gathered the eggs from the hay mow, milked the cow, and turned the calf into her, and cut wood for his mother. Penny, as always, went to the sinkhole with a wooden ox yoke supporting two wooden buckets over his thin shoulders. Ma Baxter cooked supper of poke greens and dried cow peas. She fried a frugal slice of the fresh pork.
A piece of bear meat'd go mighty good tonight, she lamented.
Jody was hungry, but Penny had little appetite. He left the table twice to offer Julia food, which she rejected. Ma Baxter rose heavily to clear the table and wash the dishes. She asked for no details of the hunt. Jody longed to talk of it, to cast away the spell of the tracking and the fight and the fear that had struck him. Penny was silent. No one noticed the boy, and he dipped deeply into the dish of cow peas. The sun set red and clear. Shadows lay long and black in the Baxter kitchen. Penny said,
I'm wore out. I could do with bed.
Jody's feet were raw and blistered from the cowhide shoes.
Me too, he said. I'll set up a whiles, Ma Baxter said. I ain't done much today, excusin' fret and worry, and mess with the sausage.
Penny and Jody went to their room. They undressed on the side of the narrow bed.
Now, if you was big as your ma, Penny said, we couldn't lay in it without somebody fell on the floor.
There was room enough for the two thin, bony bodies. The red faded from the west, and the room was dusky. The hound slept and whimpered in her sleep. The moon rose an hour past the full, and the small room lay in a silver brightness. Jody's feet burned. His knees twitched. Penny said,
You wakeful, son?
I can't stop walking.
We went a fur piece. How you like bear hunting, boy?
Well, he rubbed his knees. I like thinking about it.
I know.
I like the tracking and the trailing. I like seeing the saplings broke down and the ferns in the swamp.
I know.
I liked old Julia baying now and again.
But the fighting's right fearsome, ain't it, son?
It's mighty fearsome.
It's sickening. The dog's getting bloodied and sich as that. And, son, you ain't never seed a bear kilt.
But mean as they be, it's some way pitiful when they go down and the dogs tears their throats and they cry out just like a person and lay down and die before you.
Father and son lay in silence.
If the wild creeters would only leave us be, Penny said.
I wished we could kill 'em all off, Jody said. Them that steals off'n us and does us harm.
Tain't stealin' in a creeter. A creeter's got his livin' to make, and he makes it the best way he can. Same as us. It's panther nature and wolf nature and bear nature to kill their meat. County lines is nothing to them, nor a man's fences. How's a creeter to know the land's mine and paid for? How's a bear to know I'm dependent on my hogs for my own rations? All he knows is he's hungry.
Jody lay staring into the brightness. Baxter's island seemed to him a fortress ringed around with hunger. Now in the moonlight, eyes were shining, red and green and yellow. The hungry would dart into the clearing in swift forays and kill and eat.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.